Good morning, everybody. Thanks for coming. I'd like to tell you something about SQL, about the news in SQL, especially in the 21st century. Big surprise, there is something new in SQL in this century, quite a lot. And this is what I would like to show you because I think it can be very useful to many, many developers. So if you're using, let's say, MySQL or MariaDB, they can actually help you more than you are aware of. And this is actually the point of this talk, to make you aware of how you can use those databases with modern SQL. So what I'm using as a guidance in this talk is the SQL standard. So there is a standard, an international standard managed by ISO. And there were several releases, and you might have heard of the SQL 92 release. Who knows that term, SQL 92? Yes, you have heard that. So this is probably what you have learned. So this is 92 means the year 92, so that's quite some years ago. And, well, if your knowledge is still about SQL 92, then you're a little bit behind, because later on there was an update called SQL 99, and that was actually a big bang, because they broke with the relational idea. From SQL 99 on, SQL was not limited to relational model as you learned it or to the relational algebra as you learned it. It has exploded, basically. It broke free from this relational cage. And there are several new features, many new features, but I can only pick a few of them to show you. And the first one I would like to show you is the with recursive clause. So these are new keywords in SQL. Who knows them already? Very few, like five in the entire room. So what is it about? I'll demo just the problem, or one of the problems you can now solve more easily. And if you think of hierarchies, like I have it here in the picture. So typically you have a table where you have this parent column, which basically means, okay, every row has a parent, and this is here in this picture by these arrows, except the root node that might not have any parent. And then you can have a data structure like here and then pick any element out of that, for example, if you know the ID of that element. And then you might have questions like, how to find all the nodes below that? And the question is how to do that with SQL. And when we get started with the good old SQL 92, the first step is pretty easy, to pick one element if you know the ID. If you, for example, know that this is ID 42, then you can just take it and pick it. That's easy. But how to find the descendant nodes? And the first step is still quite easy and was still possible with SQL 92 because you can just use union all to combine another result into the very same result. And the trick here is that you use the same ID, 42 for example, but instead of searching on the ID column to fetch the first element, you are searching on the parent, so on all the rows that point to that one. So you get the next level. And you see that's quite easy so far, but on the other hand, it's game over already. We cannot go any further with this concept. We could actually add more union alls. You can add any number of union alls there. The problem is just that you would need like a grandparent pointer or grand-grandparent pointer in your table. And we don't have that. And frankly speaking, we don't want that. How to continue here? How to fetch the entire subtree there? And the basic idea we have now in SQL 99 is that we basically want just to use the output of our very own query to search for the next level based on this parent column. And this is what we now have with this recursive syntax. The syntax is quite easy, just a few lines at the top, a few lines at the bottom, that's it, that's the entire query. You can basically copy and paste it into your database, it will run. And what it does exactly what I said. It takes the output of its own query and reprocesses it at its own input. So if you look there, so here, this is how it looks like. We have this indirect self-reference there. So we are here introducing a new table alias, previous, and we are using this to access the output of our very own query. And by this way, you immediately fit and fetch all the rows down until the bottom. And you have one query, you will get one row for each of these nodes in this graph, and that's it. Just once over to the database, and you get all the results back. So this is how it looks like in SQL 99. And yeah, well, the standard, yeah, it's a little bit paper. Basically, it's paper, it's a document. And that was introduced in 99, so 20 years ago. But the problem is the vendors did not catch up so quickly. So if we look at which database supports this feature, then it looks like this. So the good news is, in the meanwhile, pretty much every major database supports that feature. But you also see that MySQL took quite a while until 8.0 last year, like with a gap of like 19 years after it was introduced to the standard. But nevertheless, today it works. Who's using MySQL 8.0 already? Okay, who's using some older MySQL? Oh my God. Yeah, well, I'll give you one or two reasons to migrate in this talk, okay? So it's a year now for GA, and I think, yeah, consider migrating. Well, that was just one feature. I'd like to show you another feature there, grouping sets. Who knows grouping sets? That's also a standard SQL feature introduced in 99. What does it do? The limitation SQL 92 had was that you could do only one grouping operation at a time. So, for example, if you have a report where you basically take some revenues on a monthly basis, so one row for each month, basically, but at the same time you would like to have a total on a yearly basis, how to do that? Here's the limitation of SQL 92 that you can have only one grouping in one query. But nevertheless, no problem, because it's SQL 92 already has great at composability. Composability was really a very, very important feature at that time. So we can, again, use union all, just combine these two results, and then you have one query with one result with all the data you have in there. Isn't it great? Yeah. Except it could be even better. So nowadays we have a different syntax for that, because the key point here is we are basically doing the same thing twice. We are doing aggregation twice. And this is now possible in the group by clause. We can basically list multiple grouping sets. That's what it's called. And the result on the left-hand side and right-hand side is exactly the same. The result is the same. It's just less code, less redundancy, and basically twice as fast at runtime. So you basically don't pay a lot of more time if you add a super total here. Can you use that in your database? There's a little bit of mixed feeling here, okay? So this is in the standard for 20 years now, and it has not been taken up as good as the previous one. You see here yellow for MariaDB and MySQL. That's because the syntax you have just seen does not work there, but they have at least the roll-up functionality. Do you know rollup? Who knows rollup and has seen that? So that's one way to use that. You could also use a different syntax to get the same result, basically, in this example. So just look for rollup in MySQL, and then you will find a similar feature. Okay, so these were just really two picked features out of the standard introduced in 99. And then there was another standard, 2003, which was another big bang, basically, for SQL, because what they introduced in 2003 was the window functions. Who knows window functions? The over clause. Come on, the over clause. Who knows? Oh my God. Well, let's put it that way. If you don't know window functions, the over clause, then you don't know SQL. It's really that way. If you don't know that single feature, you don't know SQL. Do you have SQL on your CV? You need to cross it out if you don't know window functions. I'm sorry, I'm just a messenger here. But seriously, if you don't know that feature, you don't know SQL. There was SQL before window functions, and there's SQL after window functions. That makes a big difference. The good news is you can put it back on your CV in like 10 minutes, because I'll show you. Okay, I have split it into three parts because it's a complex feature, but on the other hand, it's a powerful feature. The keyword is over. We will see why it is called over, and I will start with this partition by thingy. And again, first, let's understand the problem it solves. And the problem in SQL 92 was that two concepts were intermixed, which are actually not related to each other. The first concept is merging rules that share some common values in some attributes. You can do that with group by or even with distinct if you want to have all columns, basically. That's the one concept, so merging rows, grouping. And the other concept is using aggregate functions like sum, min, max, average, and so on. And you already know that you can, in SQL 92, you could only use aggregate functions if you're doing some grouping. And this is basically what has been broken up. I'll show it like this one. There's a query which does neither. It neither combines rows nor does it use aggregate functions. And now on this axis, I will write another query down there which does some merging of rows using distinct. So if all the values in all the columns are the same, the rows are merged. And then on the other axis, I will write whether the query is using an aggregate function or not. And on the right bottom, you can use, for example, group by, and then you are allowed to use an aggregate function like sum. And the white spot is basically what was not covered in SQL 92. Except, of course, composability. Isn't it great? We could always compose more complex queries out of the simple building blocks. So if you want to get the raw result without any rows merging, just start with that query. But if you would like next to it some result of an aggregation, no problem. Just compose the queries, do a self-join, put in the grouped stuff in there, and then you can access the aggregation next to the original data. Isn't it great? Composability. What a powerful feature, isn't it? Yeah, I can see it in your faces. It looks like, yeah. It's a truly scientific answer. The problem is solvable. But that's not very helpful in practical means, at least not always, because it's more code, more redundancy, and more runtime. So yes, it is possible, but it's not really efficient, and it's not how we would like it to do in an industrial environment. So we have now a distinct feature for that. So we can now use aggregate functions without group by. But instead of using group by, we have then another way to specify over which rows the aggregate shall be applied. And that's what we have the keyword over for. So I will show you in another example, step by step. Here's a query, and the result it may return. And the first step is quite simple, but easy to miss. Therefore, I made a pointer in here. It's a comma, because I'm going to introduce a new column to this result set. And the next step is, well, if I would like to use an aggregate function, because I would like to get some totals, then okay, go ahead, use an aggregate function. And I'm no longer required to do a grouping if I put the over clause right after the aggregate function. And even the empty over clause is a valid one, which means over everything. So that the result you get in this example is 6,000 every time, because we have six rows, each with 1,000. So that's what you get. You have an aggregate without any grouping merging of rows. But of course, you can put interesting things in this over clause, like partition by. And that segregates the result set very much like group by does. So I have here the dep column in the partition by clause, which means the rows which have the same value in this column will be put into one partition. Don't ask me why they didn't use group by here. It's basically the same. And then each of this aggregate will only see its partition. It will not be able to break out of each partition, and therefore you get different results for each partition. So this is the concept of how the over clause works. The entire name of this feature is window functions. One of the ways to use it is aggregate functions without group by. But there are even more interesting cases. Like you can also put an order by clause inside the over clause. And that might sound a little bit strange if you think about it, because it was just using sum, which means plus, 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 plus. And the last time I tried, like 1 plus 2 gave me the same result, like 2 plus 1. So why would I like to order that before doing an aggregation? And that's the whole point. It's not about the result of the aggregation function. It's about specifying which rows to actually aggregate. I'll show you an example again. So again, a query and the result it may return. Transactions, like deposit and withdrawal into some account. And I would like to get another column which tells me the balance after each transaction. So if I start with 0 and put in 10, then I would like to get a balance of plus 10. If I add another 20, it makes 30. If I take out 10, I get 20. So how to do that in SQL? Of course, SQL 92 had a great solution for that called composability. So you can put a subquery, for example, in the select clause. Just aggregate everything that happened before and up to this transaction. This is basically the condition we have here. It works. There are other ways to do that. You can also do a join for that. But you will always need to access the source table twice. It's basically a self-join all the time. And this already qualifies for this requirement. We would like to use some aggregate function, namely sum. But we do not want to do some grouping. And this is where the over clause comes into the game. So we can accomplish the very same with an over clause. So if we want to use a sum without group by, then we have to put the over right after the sum. And inside the over, I'll start with order by. And as I said, it's not to define 1 plus 2 versus 2 plus 1. It's about to chat with the database. SQL is a declarative language. We are explaining something to the database. And this order by we are putting in there because, listen, database. Right next, I will use terms like before and after. And if I do so, then this is the order I'm referring to. That's everything this order by clause does. It establishes a common understanding of before and after between me and the database. And once I have done that, I can use a between clause. Look here, rows between, unbounded preceding. This is the SQL keyword for that. That means the very first row. So that's basically a pointer to the first row in this partition. And, because it's between and, current row. And that's interesting because the current row is always a different row, basically. When the database is looking at the first row, unbounded preceding is the first row, current row is the first row, so what it basically aggregates is just a single row, therefore you get the result 10 there. But at the next row, you see that this frame has already two rows now, and they will be aggregated, and this is the result you are getting. So you can basically use relative and absolute terms there and use them to define over which rows you would like to run this aggregate function. And that's how it goes on. Just one problem. I missed something. Oh my God. See that? There's the account column. I missed to consider the account. So I was just mixing your account with yours. Not so good. How to fix it? Partition by. It's not group by here, it's partition by, unfortunately. Yeah. So you can, of course, just combine the partition by feature in there, and every single time you use the partition by, it is a partition, it cannot break out of this partition. So whatever you do then is just partition by partition. So it's so easy to just add that and fix that. So this is the prime use case for over in the order by clause. But once you have that over in the order by clause, there are some other entirely new functions that make sense. The ranking functions. So now we have not only aggregate functions like sum, min, max, count, and so on. We have a new set of functions like row number, where you get 1, 2, 3, 4, just numbering rows. So you can say now row number over order by, and then you get a sequence. But you can also get ranking. So, for example, rank and dense rank are two similar but important functions. If you look at the order criteria, I have here two times the same, B, twice. And the ranking functions, they give you the same rank if they have the same order by value. That's great. And then you have two options. You can either say the rank says, okay, there are three rows better than me, so I must have rank number 4. On the other hand, the dense rank argues the previous rank has rank number 2, so I must have rank number 3. So there are two different ways to do that. So either with gaps or without gaps. And there are some more functions that are quite useful in some not so common cases. So to summarize this over clause, it's really the defining feature of modern SQL, I would say. Whenever you would like to use an aggregate function, but grouping is the wrong thing to do in the same step, think about the over clause. That's what window functions are for. There is quite a huge flexibility in this syntax. Like, look at this, a running total. We have seen the running total before, but now also moving average. You can say rows between three preceding and three following, giving you the average of up to seven rows. So easy. Ranking, like, get me top N per group queries. I would like to get the three best results for each category. Look here. You can just number the rows, but in a partitioned way. So in each partition, you get the row numbers 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And then outside, you can filter on that result, giving you the first three, the best three, according to the order by clause, which you also put in there, result for each group or partition. Self-joins. Who's using self-joins? Who knows what a self-join is? Oh, ouch. Well, self-join used to be a required vehicle in the relational algebra. But now we have many, many features which can replace self-joins. I say like 95% of all the self-joins I see in production systems nowadays are wrong. They could just be replaced by a more modern feature giving you better performance and less trouble. Really. So self-joins is something, if you see a self-join, basically kill it. Nowadays, there's a very small odd that you still need a self-join. If you use a self-join, I keep on saying it, all employees must wash hands after using self-joins. Really, you should feel dirty. Really, who is feeling dirty after using self-joins? You should. You should. Definitely. That's one of the really defining features. What is the difference between the old SQL and modern SQL? In the purely relational cage, we had to use self-joins. They were common. That's why we even have our own name for that. But now they are basically gone, almost extinct. And I like that. And there are many more features, which are or use cases, basically, which I cannot summarize here. But what you're all waiting for is, can I use that feature in my database? Ta-da! So, who is using MySQL 5.something? Yeah, maybe you should migrate. Who has seen a reason to migrate already? Ah, yeah, okay. I'll capture the rest of you later on. Window functions is such an important feature that even the some other products, less traditional products, have implemented that. Like there's a BigQuery from Google already in 2013. Have added that feature. There are even systems which do not speak SQL at all, but still provide that feature of window functions. It's really an important feature to understand and to put into your tool belt. Okay, so this was just the really important feature out of this 2003 standard, and I would like to go on with the next one. There was another one in between, but I don't like that too much, so I skip on to 2011. Yeah, there was Offset. Offset was introduced with 2008. Who is using Offset? Ah. Have you seen next to the entry there, at the back and at the front, there is some swag you can take away. There is, for example, a coaster, a beer coaster, beer deckel. Mm-hmm. Everybody needs that. And on the back side, there's the no offset logo. There is a reason for it. I like the standard. The standard is pretty genius in many respects, but this particular feature should be crossed out. So if you're using offset for pagination, then you're doing it wrong. Offset has actually two problems. It makes your query slow, but that's the smaller problem. The bigger problem is that it doesn't give you the right answer. So it's wrong and slow. What else do you need? So if you would like to learn more about why offset is bad and actually what to do against it, grab a sticker or grab a coaster. There's a URL printed on it which explains the problems of offset as well as possible solutions. So right next to the front door and to the end, back door. But I would like to go on with window functions because I would like to show you stuff that makes sense to use. So in 2011, so 8 years after it was first introduced into the standard, it was extended. And I would like to show you one extension, which is quite awesome. It is the opposite use case as what we have had just before. Just before I had transactions, I wanted to know the balance. Now I know the balances and would like to know the difference to the previous balance. So I have the balances, and I would like to add the difference. How to do that? And I will show you just again a use case of how you can do that incredibly simple with what I have shown you already. You already know how to solve that. You just don't know it. So it's a window function. Look at this over clause. So I order by something. Of course, we need to establish some logical timely order. And then we can say rows between one preceding and one preceding might look like a typo, but isn't. That's allowed. You can go both ends in the same direction. You can say the previous row and the previous row. And that gives you just the previous row. So you have direct access to the previous row. No problem. That works. And as it is only a single row, you are syntactically required to put some aggregate function up front. But as it is only a single row, it basically doesn't matter. If you take max, for example, then it happens to work also with strings, if you need them. And this is one way which you how you can use other rows, basically. This is how this framing of window functions works. Then you have to take care, of course, of the first call of the first row, where you will get some null value and put it to zero, and then you can do the subtraction, and that's the entire query. And you can copy and paste it into MySQL 8.0, and it will work. But it goes even easier, and that is the extension we have got with 2011. Now we have direct functions to access other rows of this window, namely lead, lag. Lead and lag. Look, this is now the query today. There's a new function, lag, over order by. And it basically means giving you the access the previous row according to this order by, and then evaluate that expression, the balance. So I have direct access here to previous row, and you can also put some offsets in there. So you can lag 3 rows, 5 rows, whatever rows you would like. You could also put a default in there, so to avoid the coalesce here. That's all there. And you can use lead, so you can look downstream in your query result, look forward in time. And besides lead and lag, then there are more functions like first value and last value of this partition. And then you can even use modifiers like respect or ignore nulls. So you can say, okay, if the first value is a null, just skip over to the second one until you have something not null. That's all in there. And the usual question, can you use it yet? It's pretty much always the same. So the last one here was SQLite. Who's using SQLite, by the way? Ah, maybe on Android. So if you're using SQLite on Android, you have to wait some more years. But if you're using it somewhere else, you can basically use it right now. So it's there now in SQLite for like half a year now. Okay. Another feature. Time traveling. Who would like to go back in time? Sometimes. Who has in his business customers? Do you have customers? Seriously, do you have customers? Who has no customers? Oh my God, what are you doing? Okay, suppose you want to have customers. Can we agree on that? Okay, so customers, you know, master data of customers, like name and address, they sometimes change. And quite often we would like to keep track of these changes. And one problem of SQL, which it had from the beginning as a result of normalization, is that if you have, for example, an order table and a customers table, that the order table refers to the customer entry, but as soon as you update the customer entry, you're basically changing all the past orders as well. And this is now fixed, finally. So there's one feature called system versioning, and what it fixes is that insert, update, delete, and merge are no longer destructive. They are not destroying the old state. They're keeping track of the old state. So you can now choose to declare on a table-by-table basis to tell the database, listen, if something changes in this table, please keep track of it. Automatically and transparent. I don't want to fiddle around with that. And to do so, you have in the DDL of the table, you have to declare two columns, basically. where you tell the database, take care of them. Generate them always as row start and row end. That tells the database, okay, I'll take care of that, and I will put timestamps in there so that it marks the temporal validity of each row. So from when, tinwell, was this version valid? Then you have to logically combine it into a period, and finally you have to enable the feature with system versioning, and then bang, what's happening is you insert something, but you don't mention those columns. Because it is system versioning. The database system takes care of it. It will still propagate those columns because you told it to. Generate always as. Row start, if I run it at 10 o'clock, it will be put at 10 o'clock, and we don't know how long that will be valid yet. And as soon as you do an update, magic happens. Nothing is destroyed. It's just marking the old version. It has now an end timestamp, and there's now a new version with a begin timestamp, and we don't know yet how long that will be valid. And you guess it, if you delete something, nothing is deleted. It's just marked logically, transparently, automatically. Your application won't even notice. And if you then query after deleting it, it's transparent. You don't see that data. It's still there, but you don't see it, because transparency is a very important feature of this feature. Yeah? So why do we have it there? Of course, there's now a new syntax. So as it is a table-by-table decision, you can also specify on a table-by-table level. So in the from clause, right after the table name, you can now say for system time as of and put in any time you want. And then you see that table as of that time. So, yeah, who can see use cases for that? Mm-hmm. Who is having customers? So if you have customers, you basically need something like that, because you have that problem that, you know, they marry and things like that and change their names, and you would like to keep track of that. So can you use that in your database yet? And before I show you the slide, there's a warning. We are now in the year 2011. That's like kind of yesterday in standard terms. So it's not yet so widely supported. Oh, who's using MySQL? Who's using MariaDB? Who's using MariaDB 10.3 in production? You can use that already. It's there. So MariaDB last year with the GA release is the first major open source database to support that feature. You see that the commercial databases have that for quite some while. I know that there is something happening on the Postgres side for that, maybe. So there's big interest in there. So I think the others will catch up in a more or less timely manner. At least I hope so. I would like to show you another feature as well, which is coming to MySQL 10.4. So that's the next release, this year released of MariaDB. It is not related to system versioning, but to the so-called application versioning. Because the system versioning, it keeps track of how when we entered something into the database. That means how we learned about changes in the real world. When we go back to the customer's example, like if somebody marries and the name changes, then they are writing a letter like weeks later it will arrive at the business partners that they have changed the name like 3 weeks ago. But if you're system versioning, it will be at the time you did the update. So you're basically capturing how you learned about the changes. There is sometimes the requirement to actually track when it actually changed in the real world. So like being able to say, okay, 3 weeks ago that name changed. And that's called application versioning. And there is a lot of more syntax for that because you need to take explicitly care of it. You need to provide the timestamps. Like 3 weeks ago, that name has changed. Another use case is like starting from next month, our fee schedule changes. We have some increased prices. That works as well. Another example, quite current one, is like if you have an EU membership table where you have all the countries that are EU members. Well, if we would know the date, we could put the end date of the Brexit there already and then not care anymore. But you see, the problem is not a technical one. It's a political one. So this is what you can do with the application versioning. And for update and delete, there is a new clause, the for portion of. I will show it to you. So again, you need to declare. You can choose on table by table level to do that. You see the difference here is that you don't use these generate clauses because you have to take care of it. You have to explicitly specify, provide those timestamps. And that means you need to take care of it when you insert something. But if you're doing an update, like here, look there. It's from 10 till 12. And then I'm doing an update, but only for a portion of this time period from 10:30 to 11:30. And what happens is this single time frame here split into three, because that's in the middle of this 10 till 12. So I have half an hour with the old state, then half an hour with the new state, and finally have a remaining half hour with the old state. So this is now just a logical update where you can say, okay, this update affects that time period, and the database makes sure that whatever is in the database already is then, for example, split, like in this case. So can you use that already in your database? And the answer is pretty likely no. Who's using IBM DB2? Thought so. So the answer is no, but this is what's coming most likely. Nobody can guarantee that, but it's already in the beta of MariaDB 10.4. So that's the next major release. Just one word of warning. This feature alone is quite useless, to be honest, because you need to keep track of the primary keys. And there's another feature without overlaps primary keys, and this is not coming to 10.4. That has been shifted to 10.5. So even though this part of the feature is already there in 10.4, I think there is no practical use yet until you have the other part of this feature. So finally, let's go to the current standard release. 2016, so that's the current standard. Whoever is referring to older versions is just outdated. If somebody is referring to SQL 95, it has been outdated five times. It has been replaced five times. So 2016 is the current version. And I would just like to show you one feature, JSON table. Who is using JSON? Ah, everybody. Who knows the function JSON table? Ah. Quite a few, but there's a major gap in there. So what is it about? Nowadays, SQL has semantic understanding of documents. For quite some while, they have it since 2006 with XML. Now they have it with JSON too. So if you have a JSON document like this, the database can understand, okay, what the curly brackets mean, what the colons means, and all of that. And as SQL is a transformation language, it has also functions to transform this into more traditional table design. And this is the function I would like to show you. It's called JSON table, so there is the name. You use it basically in the from clause. You can also join to it. Let's go through it step by step. The first argument is basically a JSON document. I'm using the question mark here as a placeholder, as a bind parameter. Who doesn't know what a bind parameter is? Does not know what a bind parameter is? Who knows what SQL injection is? Okay, so if you're not using bind parameters, then you're doing it wrong. The way to put data into databases is through bind parameters. So you put some special marker in your SQL query, like the question mark, and then you use a different API call to supply the actual value for that. So suppose I'm using this API call to put in that JSON document instead of this question mark, so I provide the data it should transform. And SQL, being a declarative language, is basically all the time about declaring which rows we would like to have and which columns we would like to have. So it really starts by defining which rows we would like to have using a so-called JSON path expression. This is very similar to XPath or XQuery for XML. Who knows XQuery, XPath for XML? Okay. And if you don't know, who knows CSS selectors? Yeah, it's the same story. So this is a way how you can pick out some elements out of a document. And now we have for JSON another language called JSON path. And that expression basically means start at the root, take an array, take all the elements. You could also put in filters there and so on, but here I'm taking just everything. So I'm hitting two objects here, which also means that JSON document will be transformed into two rows in the result, like we see here at the bottom. And the only thing that's left is then declaring the columns. And you see there is a columns clause. And yeah, well, you put it a name, you give it a type, and then you're using again JSON parse expressions to put in some data out of this document. And this is basically how you can transform in the one way, and of course there are also functions to transform in the other way. Who thinks this is useful? Oh, interesting, because this is a pretty useless example. I tricked you here. Look here, I'm taking data from the client in the bind parameter and returning it back to the client. Don't do that. Don't do that. But here's the actual use case for that. You can directly insert into some table. You can use that now on the database side. So you can basically put a JSON query from the client, put it into the database, transform it into a tabular design, and insert it right away into some table. So this is an actual use case for that. Can you use that yet? Who is using MySQL 8.0? Who is willing to migrate soon? Who is motivated now? Yeah. Okay. So there are really great new features in there. And this was really just the tip of the iceberg, of course, the mandatory picture here. So the SQL standard has 4,000 pages in the meanwhile. There are many, many features. I have just 45 minutes to talk. It's too little time. So I hope you got the idea that there are useful features in there. You can do a lot of stuff in the database more elegantly, more correctly, and faster at runtime than you could do it before. So there's really a lot has happened since SQL 92. And if you're still thinking in this relational cage, if you're still using self-joins, then you're basically doing it wrong. If you don't know window functions, you don't know SQL. It's as simple as that. SQL has really broke out of the relational cage. It has evolved beyond the relational idea. You can still use the old way to do it, but quite often there are more useful ways to do it. And last but not least, if you're using SQL mostly to do CRUD operations, so to create, update, read, and delete, mostly by primary key, then you are doing it wrong. This is not what SQL was meant to be. SQL is a transformation language, which is there to transform from a persisted on-disk database model to something that is more convenient for your processing, like you have seen with the JSON table function. This is what SQL is strong at, and this is where it can help you. So the question remains, how could you know all of that? So you're lucky and attending this conference, but you can also go to modernsql.com, that's my website. So I'm blogging there. It's, of course, all free. You can subscribe it with email, Twitter, or whatever. And you can keep up with what is happening and learn and review what's there, including those charts. Does my database support that yet? And since when? It's all there. Just go there. And my name is Markus Wienand. I'm the SQL Renaissance Ambassador. Yes, that's my official title now. I was just promoted. I used to be the SQL Renaissance Minister. Now I'm the ambassador. It was a purely democratic decision, a Twitter poll. So my business is actually doing training on that. So if you're interested in that, look at wienand.at. And otherwise, just look at modernsql.com. There you can learn a lot. And I think we have like 40 seconds for questions. I'm sorry. Any questions? Yes, back there. Do window functions generate locking? Window functions are unrelated to locking. So they are basically read access and they don't influence how locking is done. So it influences locking in such a way that they are faster than self-joins. Therefore, you have less troubles. Okay. Another question? Yes, there. If I put some business logic in the database. No. So the question is, how about... Yes. So create, read, update, delete. That means if you're just doing row by row processing. So if you are just reading by primary key, if you are just updating by primary key, if you are just deleting by primary key, then you are doing it wrong. What you should do is you should collect all the data from the database, transform it on the database side into some form which is more useful for whatever problem you are solving right now, and then get it in that format from the database. Yeah, I think these are two distinct things. So the question is about how about business logic in the database, and there are strong opinions, and I don't want to go into that discussion, to be honest. We can discuss this right after, off stream. But here are two distinct things. So the one is just keeping the database as just a data store, which is okay, but then it's not using SQL. If you want to use SQL, then you can also use the database to transform this data you're storing there, which is not yet business logic. And then there's another step. You can also put in business logic, like triggers or whatever. But that's another step, and something which you may or may not want to do. But what I think has only benefits if you start using SQL to do the transformation. Like, just think about this hierarchy I was querying out of that. That is not really deep business logic that I implemented there. I just was just asking, okay, give me all the nodes that are beneath the root node there. And this is some kind of logic you can put into the database, and you have an immediate effect rather than going from the database to the client application, ping pong, ping pong, ping pong. So my point is here not about the business logic actually, but of the transformation logic that should be in SQL. So thank you again. I'm here for, let's say, another hour. My name is Markus Wienand. I'm the SQL Renaissance Ambassador. I have to get used into that. There is swag to take away. And if you have questions, just catch me. Thank you.